As we said before, we have to figure out the dependencies. Even though this program has output and anti-dependencies, again, for ILP, all we care about is the true dependencies. So we could rename this program and get just the true dependencies, or we could just look at where the true dependencies are here. So we have here, this is using R1, this is using R2 and R1, but it doesn't matter because this is going to be longer. R7 and R8 are not depending on anything yet. R3 and R7, there is a dependence here. R1 and R1, we are dependent on this instruction here, for both of them, really. And then R7 and R7, we are not using any of them. Again, we are overwriting R1 here, we are overwriting R1 here, and so on, but that doesn't matter because after renaming, all of that would be gone. So now it's time to figure out what can execute in which cycle. In the first cycle, we can execute this one. We cannot execute this one because it depends on that. We cannot execute this one because it has to wait for the second instruction. We can execute this one. It doesn't depend on anything. We can not execute this one yet because it has a dependence, this one also, but this one can execute. So in the first cycle, we managed to do our three instructions. Now, this instruction only depends on instruction that is done after cycle one, so this can be done in second cycle. This one actually depends on an instruction that is done in second cycle, so it will have to wait until the third cycle. This one depends on an instruction that is done in the third cycle, so this is going to be executed in the fourth cycle. This one can actually execute in the second cycle. It depends on an instruction that executes in the first cycle, and that's it, so it can be done in the second cycle. So what we have is the last instruction that finishes in cycle four, and we managed to execute seven instructions over that time. So we have 7 over 4, which if you want to calculate it out, it's going to end up being 1.75.